Good morning, happy Thursday, Sunrisers, and welcome to our Sunrisers Book Club chat, Beautiful Country, a memoir. It is now a New York Times bestseller, notable book of 2021, and one of Barack Obama's favorite books of the year. Author Qian, Julie Wang, shares stories of her arrival from China into poverty in the richest country in the world as an undocumented child living in New York in the mid-90s and under the cover of perpetual threat of deportation. So joining me now is Qian, Julie, someone I am proud. I think I can call you a friend now that we've met in real life a few months ago. Qian, Julie, thanks for being here and congratulations on such a big year.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm delighted to be here with you, Gia, and of course, we are friends.
Wonderful. We've got that covered. Okay, Qian, Julie, first, I just want to know, what do you make of the response your book has gotten this year?
It has been absolutely baffling and overwhelming. I really didn't think that it would resonate with as many people as it has. But one through line that I've received from immigrants, children of immigrants, and non-immigrants alike is that there are so many universal gems of childhood that is woven across all of our experiences. And that gives me hope for our ability to move forward together as a nation and understand each other across humanity.
Yeah, and as you talk about childhood, let's talk about you in this book. I mean, you moved to Brooklyn, New York when you're seven. So these stories are collected when you are 7 years old. And then it also sure sounds like you were 7 years old, too, in writing this. So it is temperamental at times. It's silly in your descriptions of other people. I really enjoyed the lady with the fake face, the airline attendant that you mentioned. How were you able to find that voice of a child as an adult that felt like, for readers like me, it felt so true, it felt so honest? Because I know that we're not the same as we were when we were seven. How were you able to do that?
Yeah, my number one goal was to have readers open up the book and feel like they were stepping into my body and seeing and experiencing the world as I did at age 7 and 8 and 9 and so on and so forth. And the biggest help for me was, I guess, reacquainting myself with my childhood self and doing a lot of talk therapy, but also meeting her anew, really, in my childhood diaries. I took a lot of copious diaries and notes because I was inspired by Harriet the Spy, and I really wanted to solve some major mystery in New York City, which never manifested. But decades later, having discovered those diary entries as an adult working on this book, it gave me keen insight into what children focus on and what their values are at that moment, that ice cream is very important and makeup is scary. And it was able to put me into that mind frame that I was, in turn, I hope, able to afford the readers.
This makes so much sense to me now because I wrote this review before we started this, and I said something to the effect of, it really feels like you're opening up a diary of sorts. And sometimes in some parts it can feel like it's your diary. So it makes so much sense that's where you took a lot of your knowledge about how you were feeling at that moment. One of the things I really found interesting was the relationship you had with your mother in this book. You were a friend, you gave her advice. She took you really seriously in other ways too as a child. And I'm just curious, did writing these stories down really open up that examination of your relationship with your mom, or had you already been doing that, as you said, with talk therapy and whatnot?
I had spent a lot of time doing that before writing this book. I think, as with all immigrant families, or even families where the parent gets ill when the child is quite young, boundaries start to collapse because your needs change and the resources that the family has at its disposal, whether because of poverty or immigration status, often morphs and blurs the line between parent and child. And I started investigating, even when I went off to college, why it was that I felt so responsible for my mother's well-being, why I couldn't just focus on my jobs and my schoolwork. And going into therapy further helped me explore that. But it wasn't really until I started writing this book that I was able to experience my mother, both from that childhood version of me and as an adult version who was older than she was at the time, seeing firsthand everything that she was struggling with so early in life, and everything that was thrown at her, and the very few resources that she had. And I was in the process of writing this, for the first time, able to appreciate that she really did the absolute best she could. And it was her voice telling me that I could make it through. I knew what to do. I could follow my instincts. That really became my survival compass throughout life.
Yeah. I think it was so fascinating to learn about your relationship with your mother. And speaking of the few resources she had, I mean, your family in general had very few resources. So we have to talk about this struggle to survive, as is noted on the front of your book here. But you talk about the hunger pangs that you felt walking around the streets of Chinatown or just going to lunch and seeing the other kids and their lunches. In a lot of cases, I wanted to grab that little girl and just hug her because I know what it feels like to grow up very hungry, Qian Julie, so, and to grow up very poor. So I sometimes have thoughts that I live this lavish life now, which by in many views is not, but where we are both coming from, it is. Now you are a Yale Law School grad, a litigator. You have your own place, your own home. Wow, okay. So how do you balance those thoughts if you have them?
Oh, every day. It's a struggle. I think someone asked me at another event whether I have survivor's guilt, and I think that is a great way to put it, because as I'm walking to my fancy office from my fancy home, not having to worry about food, it is inevitable over the course of my day that I will see on the street or run into on the subway an immigrant family, an immigrant child with her immigrant mother picking through the trash and recyclables as I did decades ago. And I am reminded that while my life has moved on, the system and the social barriers is still very much the same and very much in place for people like me who came from where they did. And when those realizations strike, and they strike several times a day, it feels like there's never enough I can do as a lawyer, as an author, as a speaker to take down those barriers. And I see those girls on the street and I want to hug them, but a strange woman hugging them is not going to help their problems. But yeah, I feel it deep in my heart. And so that's really what energizes me and makes me wake up every morning is the knowledge that there's still so much work to do and so many people like you and others out there who are similarly passionate about moving progress forward.
Yeah, and so speaking of, you know, escaping sort of the daily life that you were living at the time, libraries and the books in libraries, they became your outlet to this different world. So you talk about the Babysitter's Club, and you resonated with Claudia, one of the babysitters, because she was Asian. And I'm just curious how you think your individual growth, your identity, might have been different if you saw more of yourself reflected in these stories.
Oh, I can't even begin to fathom. I try to put myself in that mindset sometimes, like how would I have dared to dream if I saw more Asian American women on TV in less stereotypical roles, if I saw them represented in literature? And I think probably the easiest answer is that there would have been fewer caps on my ability, fewer limitations on where I dared to dream. I dreamt huge as it was because I was inspired by Thurgood Marshall and Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and I thought I could be a lawyer. If a woman can be a judge and a black man can be a judge, then maybe I can. But I didn't have that role model in the law, that model for what it meant to be a fierce and assertive woman litigator who was also Asian American. And so I think that having had those realities mirrored back to me in media and in books would have just given me that much more confidence and less of a sense that I was simply chasing a pipe dream, which is truly what I believed until I started to realize that I was doing it. And even now, it's very easy for me to slip into an imposter syndrome mentality of, oh, do I really know what I'm doing? Because I'm the only woman in this room, or I'm the only person of color in this room. And that weight of representation as well, when I meet other Asian American law students, it's heavy. And there's not a day that goes by that I don't think about that, that I'm in the courtroom, not just for me, but but for everyone to come after me.
Yeah. I mean, I hear you and I understand about that weight in my industry particularly. But you talked earlier that there's still some work to do, and you have openly talked about a series of microaggressions that you've encountered while speaking on Beautiful Country. Interviewers not pronouncing your name correctly, servers who interrupt your portion of a panel discussion, etc. Now, to me, that shows just how much work needs to be done about things like our implicit biases, even though there is high praise for works and your work, such as Beautiful Country. So I guess I'm curious, what does that say to you about equity, inclusion in this industry, in the publishing industry, and in this country?
When I switched or stepped into publishing, I thought, well, this can't be worse than law. Law is probably one of the most backwards places because it is the last place to change, right? The laws have to change, the precedents have to change before the industry and how it operates has to change. So sexual harassment is rampant, discrimination is just open. And I thought, how much worse could it be? And in publishing, it's certainly more subtle, but it's very much there. And there's this feeling of almost resentment or distaste for the authors of color who have been invited to appear at certain places. Very often women of color are put on the same panel with each other and asked just about their trauma and not their art and their craft and who they are as writers and artists. So I think I was very shocked to find what I discovered, which is that there's in the place of open discrimination, there's just a slew of microaggressions, and that can just affect you differently because it's harder to prove. It's harder to point at one single thing and say this is wrong. And so I think the task of all of us in the industry is to call things out when they happen as they happen, because until we voice them, these subtle little pricks that come at you in every which direction will cause you to bleed out and bleed to death. I am feeling my humanity kind of atrophy in these rooms, and it is not until I'm back in my safe spaces with people of color and with women of color whom I can share this openly with without having to worry about the defensive responses, where I can really regenerate my energy and my youth to keep health, to keep going out there. So I think there is a lot more work to be done. Publishing as a whole is very much run by a white crowd. But I am also seeing, especially in recent years, a real interest and effort to promote more authors of color and women of color. And I'm very excited to be a small part of that. And I hope that with our collective voices and in standing in solidarity, we can continue to push that industry toward where it needs to be.
Yeah, and I so appreciate you sharing that story because I think it resonated with a lot of people, a lot of writers of color, a lot of women writers of color as well. One of the things I wanted to pin that you had mentioned was that you're often asked about your trauma, which this book, I would say that it is about your trauma as a child coming here to America. What else would you like to write about, though? I mean, if we can move beyond our traumas.
Part of this book, it certainly is about hardship and trauma, because I don't think anyone can write about life or their childhood in particular without including the trauma, at least not an honest account. But part of this book was also a celebration of the resilience and strength of families, of immigrants, of undocumented immigrants, a celebration of how much undocumented immigrants can love America and so fervently hope to build a home and a sense of belonging in America. So I think that going forward, I'm actually currently working on a novel, and it poses and answers the question of what happens when you have achieved the material trappings of the American dream. So looking at success and how we envision success collectively as a nation and what that really means on a day-to-day. So it follows women of color in these fancy law firms that I referenced and what that actually looks like. And as they slowly learn what gives them meaning and belonging and community, how that then reflects and affects their professional lives. So I'm really really excited to be working on a novel, to be able to inject more humor and levity and more of an adult voice into my writing. And yeah, I'm just excited to see what comes of it.
And so this sounds it is fiction, but obviously inspired by some of your own experiences.
Yeah, informed by a lot of what I have observed and firsthand experience. So it's a real collage of my adult life.
Fascinating, really interesting. Okay, this kind of segues into this next section where we get questions from viewers. But one of the viewers asks, will you write the next part of your life, kind of to fill in the blanks for some viewers, or is that part just for you?
A lot of people have asked me that, so it's really funny. People chuckle when I say this, but with Beautiful Country, I didn't actually think the book was about me. It was about being an early immigrant. It was about being a child and how childhood forms a person. It was about America. And so when people finish a book and they say, "We really want to know about you," I was just repeatedly shocked because I had not thought of the book that way, even though it was a memoir. But now that I have gotten the question many times, and I have been thinking about how to kind of frame a subsequent book or books, I think that I could see myself coming back with another installment because people really want to know what happened, and I have many more stories to share that are not just about me, but also about, again, what it means to be a teen, an adult, a lawyer, someone just struggling to make it in a fancy school. So I do think that after I take a stab at this novel, I will consider going back for a second installment.
Well, there you have it for our viewers. I was really curious about that one, too. Okay, reader Sheila W. asked this question. She said, have you ever been back to China? And if so, was it as amazing as you remembered in your book? And if not, do you have plans to go back?
I went back, I'd say 3 or 4 times. I haven't been back as often as I would like. I've been trying to go back the past 2 years, but due to the pandemic, it's just been near impossible. And I still have grandparents there. I miss them dearly. I wrote an essay about this, about how every time I go back to China, I feel that the emotional side of me is unlocked. And I touch on this at the end of my book as well. And I noticed that every time I went back, I would not be able to keep myself from crying. It's as if I'm reliving everything that I've missed, all the years that I've missed with family. When I'm back on that soil, I just feel it so acutely that I have missed out on so much time. And I can't help but think what my life or who I would be different if I had stayed in China. And when I get on that plane back to JFK, every single time without fail, I feel the rational, logical, contained side of me coming back, that armor coming back to me, and just becoming more composed and more numb in a way. And so I think that's a really fascinating, whether it's psychological effect or something else, it's just a fascinating phenomenon that I've experienced, and I think that many immigrants can probably relate to it, how their homeland kind of has a key to a side of their heart that other places cannot. So I love going back to China. I miss my family a great deal, but it's a conflicting experience due to the political differences that my family has with the government and due to this a well of emotion that seems to bubble up only when I'm there.
And when you say that other immigrants can relate to that, I definitely can. Right before our interview, I was watching some archive video here at our station that we did about Hmong refugees, and I was starting to weep. And it's in your bones. I've never been back to Laos, but it is in your bones when you go back to your native country. So thank you for sharing that. We have some rapid fire questions for you right now. You ready?
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay. There's six of them. Okay, first one, if you could do one thing only, one thing, would it be litigating or writing?
Writing.
Okay. True or false, you wrote your first draft of this book on your phone while commuting on the subway.
True.
Which is wild. So crazy. A lot of people don't believe you on that one. Okay, one thing you tell an aspiring writer.
You may think that what you're writing sucks because that's what I think. Just keep writing. Do not stop. Do not delete. Just get that first draft down and worry about everything else, including editing and deleting the stupid stuff later.
Okay. Just keep writing, even if it's on your phone. Okay. True or false? You've converted to Judaism?
True.
True. Okay. And five, you have two dogs now, but your first pet, as we learned in your book, was a cat. Are you more of a cat or dog person?
Ooh, I love all animals and I'm vegan for that reason, but I'd have to say dog.
Dog. Perfect. And salty, it's salty and peppers, right?
Me and peppers, yeah, and they can't wait to meet Teddy.
I know. Teddy's so excited to have some friends. Okay, finally, six, what are you reading right now?
Right now, I am reading a beautiful novel called Brown Girls. It's by my friend Daphne Andreas. It's coming out January 4th, and it's a lyrico-poetic novel about brown girls growing up in Queens, and she uses the we narrative voice, just like in Virgin Suicides and in some other artistic novels, and it's just absolutely breathtaking. It reads like a song, like a poem, and you feel like you're again walking around in these women's bodies and experiencing everything that they are.
Oh my gosh, beautiful, beautiful. Qian Julie Wang, author of Beautiful Country, a memoir. Thank you so much for your time this morning.
Thank you.